to me.
Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null, broadcasting live and video streaming live from our studio in New York City. You can watch today's program by going to GaryNull.com or ProgressiveRadioNetwork.com. Today, lots of information. I'm going to give you the most comprehensive reasons why you should be consuming the omega-3 fatty acids, either from vegan sources or fish sources. We have Pat Robinson of GreenInfo, MedInfo.com to thank for analyzing all this. All this, by the way, comes from mainstream peer-reviewed literature, as every day we let you know that. Now, why? Because with hundreds of thousands of new listeners regularly tuning in, I want them to know that we have outstanding science in the world today and in the United States. But we have to balance that science against the official science that represents organizations, corporations, think tanks, lobbying groups that take the official information, almost never objective and never come true, versus the legitimate science. So we deal with legitimate peer-review science, not official science. Hence, we will look at hundreds of articles from around the world every single day and select those that you're not hearing about. Also, how does meditation affect your risk of a heart attack or stroke? It does, and I'll share that with you today. Coming up, pomegranate, but not the seeds, the little orbs inside that are delectable. I'm talking about the peel, you know, that red kind of hard peel. Well, that actually has some unique healing properties in it. Terrific in a way we never knew. So for those who have been eating your compounding powders, that's the whole fruit. The whole fruit gets pulverized without heat, blended, and with the water removed. So that you're getting. And just eating a pomegranate, you wouldn't. Also today, ginseng, more than 5,000 articles just in the Japanese peer-reviewed scientific literature, another 5,000 in the Chinese. It does something really important. And if you have a kid in the United States that is using a cell phone, and most young people do, a warning, and I'll tell you what that warning is. My guest in the second part of our program today, actually the third part of our program, about a half hour from now, will be Christopher DeBellege. He is a British award-winning journalist and author with expertise in Iranian and Indian studies and Persian language. He worked and lived in the Middle East and South Asia. He writes for The Economist, Financial Times, and The Independent in the UK. We're going to talk about something today that is just never discussed, and that is the Anglo, meaning the English, American coup d'etat that toppled Iran's best hopes in a secular progressive nation. Now, why is this interview important? Why would I do this? Because how many of you out there believe that Iran represents a threat, that the mullahs, the Ayatollah, the religious fanaticism, the extreme version of the Shiite belief, and it's Shiite in Iran, and it's Wahhabism or Sunni in Saudi Arabia, why that is such a danger and threat to us? Is it? How do you know? Where did it evolve from? Was there a time when we could have worked with Iran and its leaders? Was it ever a democracy? Did it ever offer people freedom? This is why it's so important. You have to understand before Israel, with our full backing, invades the military structure of Iran and causes the next world war, which is highly problematic, and causes economic devastation, except for the speculators and commodities like oil that will go $300 a barrel or $17 to $18 a gallon of gasoline. What you don't know, what you should know, what we should have the honesty and decency to teach in every class in America, our real history of intervention. Now, I produced a five-hour documentary, a radio documentary, called Intervention, in the name of peace, freedom, and democracy, which shows that without exception, in every country for the last 200 years, where we've gone in to give them freedom and peace and democracy, we've really gone in for regime change to control their resources, privatize their natural resources to our benefit, and use our military and our media to cover. That's why this program is so important. Now, if time permits, and I'm not sure it will, I don't know how long that interview will go, I intend to share a commentary of why we are needing a lesson in academic history. You may think that, gee whiz, that's going to be boring. I can promise you this commentary will not be boring. But I will show you why I am opposed to Harvard University's concept of education today, the darkness in academia. And that will be from the great work of Professor John Cozy. And I will give my interpretations. I've written extensive commentary. Also today in our environmental segment, you've heard me talk about why it's so important that we understand the tipping points and how for almost 8 years I've been working on a major documentary handbook on the tipping points. Recently, just a week ago, I stopped people near Columbia University who attended, both faculty and graduate students, and I asked a simple question. Name me the 12 tipping points. Well, no one could even name me two tipping points. Why should this be of concern to you? This came out today. This is what it means to be ahead of the curve in a bad way. This is from the most respected scientific journal in the world, Nature. Quote, the Earth is facing imminent environmental tipping points, biosphere reaching an environmental state shift, say scientists. Humankind is facing an imminent threat of extinction. Let me repeat that. Humankind, that means everyone on Earth, is facing an imminent threat of extinction, according to new research released from the journal Nature. The report, entitled Approaching a State Shift in Earth's Biosphere, reveals that our planet's biosphere is steadily approaching a tipping point, meaning all ecosystems are nearing sudden and irreversible change that will not be conducive to human life. That is why I continue every single day, without exception, to provide you with additional insights into environmental issues. Why is that important? Because no one in the Obama administration, and I mean no one, gives a damn about our environment is doing anything about it. To the contrary, they do these dog and pony shows, and the Republicans, they can't even spell environmental, let alone act on it. Corporate America has no interest in it. So where does that leave you? How about screwed? So we'll get to that and why these are the issues that should be talked. You're not going to see Ed Schultz or anyone else in the official corporate liberal media discussing these, because then they would have to make accountable this current administration or previous ones who are contributing. So if you think that something's being done on your behalf, the world's behalf, the forests, the rivers, the oceans, the creeks, the streams, the biosphere, the hemisphere, no. It's up to the grassroots. It's up to you and I. So over the next 6 months, I will give you positive input of what we can do to take back our environmental mood. It's totally corrupted. I wouldn't give a nickel to any environmental organization out there. That doesn't mean every person is corrupted. It means the head of these organizations have been compromised by the very polluting industries. So we can take back our environmental movement. And we will. Now let's begin. Meditation is very important for a lot of reasons. It can de-stress us. It can allow us to better focus our attention. It allows us to stop multitasking and look at what's in front of us, around us, so we hear, sense, smell, and see the world for what it is, mindful in that moment. We're not always thinking ahead or projecting back. We're just in the moment. That's one of the things that meditation can do. It can ground you. In effect, it can take this hyperkinetic energy that so many people today have, they're all over the place, and simply say, calm down and focus. Here is the latest, as published in Evidence-Based Complementary and Alternative Medicine, done at the Medical College of Georgia and Georgia Health Sciences University. Quote, meditation can decrease the risk of cardiovascular disease in teenagers. In a study of 62 black teens with high blood pressure, by the way, that in itself should raise an alarm. No teen should have high blood pressure. This is the diet. Those who meditated twice a day for 15 minutes had the lower left ventricular mass, an indicator of future cardiovascular disease, than a control group. So, one more tool that we can use. Why not put into the curriculum meditation? Now, it is possible to do it within some public schools based upon the cooperative nature of the principal, the teachers, and the administrators. And, of course, the parents. Get your background on this. I'm posting today a number of articles of why our children should be taught meditative techniques. It can stop them from becoming hyperactive. I'm willing to bet that if every teacher in America spent 15 minutes a day with a meditation, even if it was an elective, even if they could come in after school or before school and just take a meditation class, you would reduce hyperactive reactions, which would otherwise be falsely diagnosed as brain chemical imbalance, ADD and ADHD, and medicated. You could calm those kids down. And I believe if you showed parents the importance of this, they would support it. For those of you with charter schools, you have more flexibility. You can do this. Just as recently, I visited 3 charter schools in New Jersey and helped set up holistic food programs. They're going to be juicing, and I gave them recipes and juices. I showed them where to buy their organic produce from local distributors. And now they're going to be juicing. They're going to give them natural foods instead of the junk stuff that comes in that is fed, the garbage that's fed in main schools. So you can do this. So I'm asking you now, and I know a lot of you are listening from charter schools, begin to implement a regular daily meditation for faculty and students to calm them down, get them focused, and it will help them on all levels, plus save their lives. So that's good news. Now, I believe that we should be taking the omega-3 fatty acids on a regular basis. But a lot of people don't know why. I want to give you the reasons. Now, I'm going to go through them rather quickly. You can always replay this program from the archive, and because I don't think you'll be able to write it down, but you'll get the reasons why. It'll stick in your memory. First, and all this is based upon peer-reviewed literature. I'm not going to cite, as I normally do, all the studies. I'm just going to go through why you should take your omega-3s. And I'm suggesting 2 teaspoons a day of the oil. I'm also suggesting everyone should be taking raw organic coconut oil, 1 teaspoon to a tablespoon a day. If you've got inflammation in your body, if you've got viral activity, hepatitis, herpes, cytomegalovirus, a tablespoon twice a day. It's beneficial in bipolar. It reduces mania and depression in juvenile bipolar disorder. It benefits rheumatoid arthritis, asthmatics, reduces oxidative stress and neuropathy. It lowers your blood pressure. It improves cardiovascular risk profile. It reduces cardiac deaths. It reduces incidence of sudden cardiac death. It reduces total death from all causes. It prevents sudden death. It reduces total mortality and sudden death in patients already who've had a heart attack, so you have less likelihood of having a second heart attack. It reduces coronary heart disease. It reduces coronary calcium scores and slows plaque growth. It prevents atrial fibrillation after coronary artery bypass. It's beneficial for attention and behavioral and emotional problems in children and adolescents. It's great for kids with autism. It is important for diabetics. type 1 and type 2. It is good for endothelial function and peripheral artery disease, peripheral vascular disease, reduces the risk of peripheral artery disease substantially. It's great for cystic fibrosis. It protects against mucus overproduction caused by pulmonary bacterial colonization in cystic breast. Hence, it's good for fibrocystic breast disease. It reduces inflammation biomarker, urethrocyte sedimentation rate. It is really good if you have bacterial infections. If you have chronic hepatitis C, it's terrific. If you have lupus erythematosus, it's good. If you have had a heart attack, it's in women specifically good and prevents heart attack in women. It decreases inflammation and prevents overload of the cardiac dysfunctional state. It improves cognitive impression, meaning it lessens cognitive decline. It's good for dry eye syndrome. It's good for ADHD. It reduces ischemic stroke in men. It prevents and reverses insulin resistance. It prevents the formation of urinary calcium oxalate stones that end up with calcified oxalates, which can be kidney stones. It's good with bronchial asthma. It prevents early preterm birth. It reduces prostate cancer-specific morbidity. It decreases the severity of autoimmune disorders. It's an attenuating pulmonary hypertension therapy. It helps with glaucoma. It alleviates insulin resistance and fatty liver. It reduces prevalence of allergies. It reduces the need for nonsteroidal anti-inflammatories with rheumatoid arthritis. It reduces the risk of breast cancer metastasis. It reduces the risk of smokers who have congestive conditions. So those are some of the reasons why you should be taking your omega-3 fatty acids every day. I'm Gary Null. Back in a moment. Please stay with us. Welcome all of you, I'm Gary Null. Time for a commentary, and I'll be offering a commentary every single day because I believe that we need to look at different ways of approaching our problems. Let me quickly mention that I believe that my premiere of the new film, The War on Health, at the Matter of Health in Rockland Plaza in Nanuet is full. I believe they have 400 people. But you can call for yourself. It's next Tuesday at 7 p.m., 845-627-3333. We are packed. There is no room at the 1,000-seat that we're going to be having on Friday. However, I am setting aside a will-call line, meaning people who will show up, and we, on a first-come basis, they pay cash, and they can get in. We're holding aside 50 total seats. You can call Jeremy if you'd like to do a will call. It's at 7 p.m. next Friday evening. And that is 646-926-5434. 646-926-5434. But otherwise, we're packed. Now, I would like all of you to know that this is one of the most important films that I have ever done because it could help us challenge the bureaucracies, the corruption between ALEC and its lobbying groups, and the power they have over our health, because it exposes them, all of them. Individuals that exposes them, corporations, governmental bureaucrats, how they go from a corporation back into the government, in the government back into the corporation, the musical chairs, the politicians that they influence with money that they give. I show you the politicians, how much they gave, what they voted on, what they didn't vote on. I show you the lobbyists that had never been seen before. You see who they are. I show you everything about these individuals, because only by seeing the total truth and how close they are to creating a complete removal of your right to eat organic produce at all, and you have to understand how they've done it. They're very smart. They did it with Senate Bill 510, and they've done it with this dietary. They're implementing Codex Alimentarius, which they did succeed in Europe. You got to go to Norway today. You think you can walk in and buy zinc? 10 milligrams? No. You have to have a prescription for $50. You think you can go into Germany or England and just buy what you want? No, you cannot. 900 different supplements and herbs were taken off the market this past year. And then they start to say, what happened? Well, you were asleep. You chose not to address it. You chose not to make it important. And while you were not paying attention, they took away your freedoms, because the pharmaceutical industry did not want you competing with something that could help you when they had a drug that would not. We are at that place in the United States. If we do not rally together, if we do not work together, then we will all lose our freedoms of choice. This is the tool that we will need. That's why I'm asking you to watch the documentary from home at 7 p.m. There'll be a live screening, then a live panel. I will not tell you who's on the panel. You'll see for yourself, but it's powerful. This is not a fun film. This is a film I've filmed in secret for 3 years. It is devastating. I do not pull a punch. I figure if they're going to go after us, which they are, if they are abusing the Constitution, which they've shredded it, interesting, a Nobel Peace Prize winning is one of the greatest warmongers in the history of the United States, one of the people who said transparency is never saw something he wouldn't now classify and go after whistleblowers, and then a constitutional scholar who spent years at the University of Chicago teaching constitutional law now takes away our constitutional rights. Is somehow this seeming more and more like a Orwellian and Faustian play, commingling such absurdities? Well, this all gets shown in this film. So I want every one of you to tell a friend, another friend, watch this, download it, share it with as many people as possible. You see, they control the New York Times. They control the media. They control everything out there in the official banking, education. You know, if not, then we would have tens of millions of people gathering around saying no more. No more student loan debt, no more home foreclosures, no more hungry children. We're not doing anything about anything. We make these supercilious, stupid little efforts that everyone gathers around as if these are the important issues in the mainstream media and the left media. They are not. Your rights and freedom and your health are important. Let me give you one example. More Americans died this year than all of American casualties in the First and Second War, the Korean War, and the Vietnam War combined. You think that maybe that would get someone's attention, that we need to address a problem? Not at all. So these are the real problems we're facing, and I bring all this up in the film. Anyhow, so now you know why it's so important, because if you go to sleep on this one, mark my words, the day will come when you won't have any organic produce. You will only have genetic engineered produce. You won't have any supplements. You won't have any herbs. You won't be able to go to a nutritionist of your choice. That'll all be behind you. And I mean, it is there now. This isn't future. This is right now as we speak. So I would suggest that this is an important issue that we should pay attention to. At least watch and then determine what you want to do from there. And we will have calls to action. So that's next Friday, worldwide premiere. And by the way, just this morning, Jeremy told me, gee whiz, Gary, in the last hour, 1,200 people are on board just in the last hour to watch it. So we're going to have a big audience. It'll be in the millions. One of the things that concerns me is that how little understanding of history that we have in the context that it is needed today. Knowledge does not always prevail or even endure. When the empire fell, the Justinian Code was replaced by canon law. What does this mean? In the 11th century, people began to study, rediscover Greek and Roman texts. The darkness of the age had begun to lift, but the lifting took several hundred years before we fully understood it. Today, nothing ensures the light's endurance despite our pious accolades of learning and science. I believe we are immersed in anti-intellectualism, and it's never been stronger than it is today. It continues to live in the dark alcoves of the religious institutions of the Middle Ages, and the establishment carryovers today in the fundamentalist vocational training institutions. During the Golden Age of Greece, in Athens, it was populated by enough curious people to cause Aristotle to write, "All men by nature desire to know." I would challenge that. I believe he was wrong. But his compatriots certainly had an intellectual bent. Athens experienced a period during which the Parthenon was built, and the city became the artistic, cultural, and intellectual and commercial center of what was known as the civilized world. Among its inhabitants were Socrates and Plato and Aristotle and Aristophanes and Euripides and Sophocles, the sculptors, the orators, Herodotus. They were all there. A love of learning was prevalent, and the Socratic method, consisting of asking questions until the essence of a subject is found by eliminating the hypotheses that lead to contradictions. That was where it was developed. And mathematics was expanded by Pythagoras and Archimedes. And the scholars all wanted us to learn. Rome, by contrast, was never populated by enough curious people to learn it about its own insights. It had no real intelligentsia. The Romans were a plundering people. They took what they wanted by killing, if necessary. Rome had made papal Christianity the state religion, and when the empire fell, the Justinian Code was replaced by canon law. And hence we evolved into no longer curious about real learning, a virtual extinguishing. We entered the Dark Ages. In the 11th centuries, individuals from across Europe began to study the rediscovered Justinian Code. Soon, the study of Roman law and other rediscovered subjects spread, and papal Christianity came into conflict with itself. The election of two claimants to the papacy created a schism. The split led to the establishment of the new centers of learning and the decline in the authority of the church. Learning began to reassert its place, and eventually both the Renaissance and the Enlightenment emerged along with an interest in humanism. The darkness of the age had begun to lift, but the lifting took several hundred years and was never completed. Today, nothing ensures the light's endurance despite our pious sense that we are the gifted ones. How many times have you heard individuals say we are the best and the brightest? Oh, because of Harvard. I'll get to that. The darkness that developed and enveloped the Dark Ages in Europe emanated from the monasteries, the abbeys, the scholastic universities of the Middle Ages. It consisted of the ideology that was thought to be the divinely inspired truth describing all things in the universe, which itself was known as the creation. It tolerated no dissent, which brought about heresy trials and executions in the Holy Inquisition. Almost everything that would be considered learning today was suppressed. And even when the church's influence declined and heresy trials and the Inquisition ceased to exist, vestiges of the darkness were kept secure in other institutional ways. The love of learning that emerged in classical Greece never regained its augustness. Anti-intellectualism never died. It continued to live where it had so many other times in the minds of closed individuals. 200 years before the Age of Reason, Massachusetts was a religiously conservative Puritan colony that repeatedly deported, cast out, and even executed people who disagreed with ideological Puritan doctrine. Although never formally affiliated with the church, Harvard College was established in 1636 by the Massachusetts legislature primarily to train Congregationalist and Unitarian clergy. The Puritans in Harvard College at that time can only be described as Christian fundamentalist. The college offered a classical academic curriculum altered to be consistent with Puritan ideology. This curriculum emulated that of Cambridge University, which itself was founded by a papal degree. It was a papal university. In short, Harvard was the Liberty University of the day, a Bible school, and its function was distinctly religious. It was not established as a place of universal learning. Harvard's curriculum and students did become secular in the 18th and 19th centuries when it emerged as the central cultural establishment among Bostonian elites. Following the Civil War, the college and its affiliated professional schools were transformed into a centralized research university, but its professional schools then as now were vocationally oriented. The university's goal was and is to teach people to operate in an ideologically biased market economy, as is shown by its history and influence and wealth. It has the largest financial endowment of any academic institution in the world, and eight U.S. presidents have been graduates. Harvard is also the alma mater of at least 60 billionaires. It is America's cathedral of the moneyed elite, and it promotes establishment ideologies rather than universal learning. It began America's addiction to the schools of business administration, having founded the first one in 1908, 12 years before it established its College of Education. Only in the late 19th century was the favored position of Christianity eliminated from the curriculum by replacing it with another ideology, transcendental Unitarianism. Harvard is an institution where belief has always trumped knowledge. But it's not that way anymore, is it? Surely not. Well, it certainly is. Consider this view of how economists teach economics at Harvard. Quote, students at Harvard University recently walked out of Greg McAuley's Economics 10 Principle class because of alleged ideological bias in his presentation. Stephen Margolis, also at Harvard, staged teach-in about the Manakaiwe walkout. Margolis discussed his attempt to offer an alternative economic principle course at Harvard, which was rejected by the economics faculty and then accepted only as an alternative study course. Students at Harvard, like students at many other schools, are not allowed to learn about alternatives to the neoclassical model and get credits towards the major, end quote. So this is Harvard, the brightest light in America's educational pantheon, often criticized by conservatives as too liberal. I doubt it. But it's not just Harvard. Yale was founded in 1701 to train ministers and lay leaders in Connecticut. 10 Congregationalist ministers, all of whom were alumni of Harvard, established the school. When a rift formed at Harvard between Increase Mather and the rest of the Harvard clergy, whom Mather viewed as increasingly liberal and ecclesiastically lax and overly broad in church policy, he praised the success of Yale in the hope that it would maintain the Puritan religious orthodoxy in a way that Harvard had not, just another Liberty University. And then Leland Stanford, the founder of Stanford, visited Harvard's president, Charles Eliot, and asked how much it would cost to duplicate Harvard in California. Stanford became the Harvard of the West, just another conservative fundamentalist university. Its founding came in 1885 in an endowing grant which made several specific stipulations, including, quote, the trustees shall have the power and it shall be their duty to establish and maintain at such university an educational system which will, if followed, fit the graduate for some useful pursuit, to prohibit secular instruction. I repeat, to prohibit sectarian instruction, but to have taught in the university the immortality of the soul, the existence of an all-wise benevolent creator, and that obedience to his law is the highest duty of man, end quote. So when Senator Stanford died in 1893, Jane Stanford took over, and after Edward Ellsworth Ross became recognized as the founding father of American sociology, she fired him for radicalism and racism. She also directed that the students be taught that everyone born on Earth had a soul and that on its development depends much in the life here and everything in the eternal life thereafter. And she forbade students from sketching nude models in live drawing classes. So Stanford, too, embodied strong fundamentalistic characteristics. These universities were established as fundamentalist vocational training institutions by ignorant people. They were not established to further knowledge. They're madrasas, schools for Sunday, one and all. So liberty universities are as American as Johnny Appleseed, and they apparently are self-reproducing. They exist through the United States, some openly and some, like Harvard, Yale, and Stanford, covertly. Vocational training in the American educational scheme was furthered by the founding, after the Civil War, of our land-grant colleges, and a number of institutions have been founded, like the London School of Economics, to openly promote market-based capitalism. For instance, Hillsdale College, which was founded in 1844, 200 years after Harvard, describes itself as grateful to God for the inestimable blessings resulting from the prevalence of civil and religious liberty and the intelligent piety in the land, and believing that the diffusion of the prevalence of civil and religious liberty shall be its goal. The college considers itself a trustee of sound learning and to essentially perpetuate these blessings. Prominent conservative theorist Russell Kirk had a substantial career there, and the college houses and displays the personal library of Austrian economist Ludwig von Mises. Corporations have also donated huge sums to colleges and universities to promote orthodox classical capitalism. BB&T, for instance, the nation's 10th largest financial holding company, pledged $1.5 million to the University of Georgia's Terry College of Business, quote, to expand teaching and research in the foundations of capitalism and free market economy. All of this seems to be contradicted by America's addiction to science and technology. But America has no devotion to science, and the proof is obvious. Evolution is dismissed because it conflicts with biblical accounts of creation. Climate and environmental sciences are dismissed because they conflict with free market capitalism. Not only are the sciences dismissed, the scientists engaged in them are reviled. What Americans are devoted to is the catalog of consumer products that engineers create out of the scientific discoveries that had no hand in. The president says we need to train more scientists and mathematicians, but look at who the people are that Americans admire most. Bill Gates, the late Steve Jobs, and Mark Zuckerberg. Neither is a mathematician, nor a scientist, nor even a college graduate. Our respect for science is as shallow and just contradictory as a dried-up pond, and all we do is swallow in its mud. If Americans do a genuine respect at any point for science, they would have a respect for the scientific method, which rejects ideas that cannot be confirmed empirically. Americans, on the other hand, insist on continually implementing ideas that are not only not verifiable empirically, they can be shown not to work at all. How many times on this program have I suggested that every time any human being, no matter what their background, Nobel Prize winners or not, when they challenge the orthodoxy with their findings, they are immediately dismissed and kicked to the side. That is common. That is why we have no respect as a nation officially for the alternative health or humanistic or spiritual movements at all. Hence, no mind-body spiritual training, no truth in economics, no alternative position at all. List all the practices carried out by Americans that do not work and have never worked, well, then you're going to have a big journal. No culture with respect for science would function this way. And yet that is how we function. But as though all of this were not bad enough, even this conservative educational system is under attack by ideological fundamentalists. And that is a fact. Again, America's professional community and their administrations are nowhere to be found when it comes to creating real education and true secular principles. What are they thinking? Have they tried to imagine what their classrooms will be like when their students have all been indoctrinated with fundamentalistic ideology? What will these professors be able to teach? Which subject that conflict with fundamentalist ideology will be prescribed? What kind of speech will be considered politically incorrect? In Europe, people can be imprisoned for denying that the official Zionist account of the Holocaust is true. Will teachers of evolution become criminals if they deny that the biblical account of creation is true, or if marriage doesn't consist of a union of one man and one woman? Why not? Churchmen did it to Galileo. Ask yourself how many German university professors bore the consequences of Nazi ideology. Those professors who couldn't support Aryan superiority, what happened to them? They were imprisoned or shot. Think it won't happen here? It's already happening. For decades now, our public school teachers have been under attacks disguised as attempts to render them accountable. The Department of Education assumes that standardized test scores can reliably and validly be used to determine teacher quality. Most researchers say the tests cannot. They say that using test scores in this way is a negative consequence of the No Child Left Behind Act. And for decades, the college and university community have been silent on their graduates who have been vilified. But now, the educational department just tried and failed to persuade a group of negotiators to agree to regulations that would rate colleges of education in large part on how K-12 students being taught by their graduates perform on standardized tests. How foolish. In conclusion, for the first the professors and teachers' colleges, then the professors and business colleges, then the professors and technical schools, and now on and on. Backwardsness never turns its head. Professors throughout the world stalk up with hubris, and where are they? In the darkness. Back in a moment. Please stay with us. Nice to have you with us, everyone. Let us go to London, England, and say hello to my guest, Christopher. Is it Belaig?
Exactly, brilliantly pronounced.
Thank you, Belaigue. He is a British journalist and author who has experience in Iranian and Indian studies and Persian language. He has lived and worked in the Middle East and South Asia, writing for The Economist, Financial Times, The Independent of the UK. He has written several books. His Rebel Land won the 2010 Orwell Award. His most recent book is Patriot of Persia, Muhammad Mossadegh and a Tragic Anglo-American Coup. Nice to have you with us today.
Thanks for having me.
I'm concerned that we in the United States are not fully aware of the history of Iran, and therefore those who wish to see Iran destroyed or its nuclear capability destroyed, which we know would have enormous blowback consequences. After all, in all likelihood, China, India, Russia, Brazil, in all probability, would stay aligned with Iran, and there would be enormous conflict between Saudi Arabia and Iran, and what would happen to the price of oil. But before we even think of that as a consequence, why don't we put this in proper perspective to show what actually happened in Iran that we were so offended by, and the British, that we decided to work together to unseat the elected officials and to change the entire regime to our need and put the Shah of Iran in his place. Could you give us this history, please?
I can, and I would like first to say that you're absolutely right to put what's happening today into a much longer perspective and to see why it is that we've come to the position where distrust on both sides is so ingrained, both sides don't really understand each other, and they don't, in some ways, seem to want to understand each other. Now, what happened in 1953, which you're referring to, is that Mohammad Mossadegh, who, as you say, was the popular prime minister of the country, 2 years before that, he had nationalized the Iranian oil industry, which the British had built and invested in, and which had become one of the pillars of the British Empire. The Iranians thought, after a while, that they were being fleeced, they weren't seeing enough revenues, and more than that, Mossadegh regarded the British presence in Iran, all that infrastructure, all those officials, all those interfering diplomats, as a genuine threat to the independence of the country. And he was right to do so, in my opinion. In 1951, he engineered the nationalization of the industry. And the British, naturally, were absolutely appalled because solvency and pride were at stake. And the British Empire was in a state of falling down about their ears. So what the British did was that they started, on the one hand, a diplomatic process to try and have nationalization reversed. But Mossadegh was supported by the vast majority of his people, who thought that the oil industry should be in Iranian hands and that the British should accept his offer, which was of compensation. The British did not, and the diplomatic process took 2 years to eventually grind to a halt. The Americans, all the while, were playing the role of honest broker. They obviously had a historic regard for Britain and British interests, but at the same time, they recognized that Mossadegh was a bulwark against communism, that he, as a Democrat, as a Western-inclined Democrat, could prevent the communists from taking over in Iran. The British were working on the Americans and saying, in fact, Mossadegh was being supported by the Iranian Communist Party. And eventually, the Eisenhower administration was persuaded and convinced by the British that this was the case. Erroneously, in fact, as the historians and as I have pointed out in this book. So in 1953, what happened is that the CIA launched a coup which toppled Mossadegh. Mossadegh, at the same time, had been a constitutionalist politician. He thought that the Shah should reign, not rule, and the Shah didn't like that. So the Shah aligned himself with the coup makers and the plotters. And when Mossadegh was ejected from power, the Americans put the Shah back into a position of supreme power, a position from which he built himself the dictatorship that was eventually toppled in the 1979 Islamic Revolution.
So if people understand what you're saying, I don't want to misrepresent you here. We had a man who was put into power properly, Mossadegh, but then when he wanted to have equality in the gross exploitation of his oil reserves by the British and British Petroleum, the British petroleum interests working with Eisenhower and one of his chief secretaries, the Dulles brothers, formed a coup with the British. They toppled him and put the Shah of Iran in his place. And for years, decades, the Shah of Iran ran one of the most brutal and repressive dictatorships in the world. And it was only because of that that the Ayatollah was able to come into power and their blowback occurred. But we never talk about how our manhandling, our regime change, our support of a dictator, a murderous person, led to the taking back of their own country. We leave that whole section of this story out. Is that what you're saying?
It's not convenient to dwell on that, but it is true. And there's no point beating ourselves up over the past. But we must learn from these mistakes. And the biggest thing that we need to learn is that there is no silver bullet in geopolitics and in international affairs. The Americans thought, and the British thought too, that by ejecting Mossadegh with the simple expedient of a coup, they were solving all their problems. The oil industry would revert to to the cozy arrangement that had been in place before, only this time with more American participation. The Shah, who was pro-Western and strongly anti-communist, would take his rightful place, and America would have a strong ally. And of course, it didn't work out like that because the Shah was unaccountable. He became more dictatorial as his reign went on. In the 1970s, he found himself swimming in oil money because of the oil price hikes of the early 1970s. He misused that. His governments were inept and incompetent. And in the end, what you had was in 1979, although Iran was now by then an extremely prosperous place and prospering very unevenly but dramatically, it was the regime was toppled by the revolutionaries.
I understand that M16 files regarding the deposing of Mossadegh have yet to be made public. What do you know about the actual activities and motives of the British to foment a coup to oust him? And also, Madeleine Albright had apologized on behalf of the U.S. for its involvement in getting rid of Mossadegh and replacing him with the Shah. This is an admission of guilt, since Albright would certainly have been known the intelligence history of Iranian-American relations back then. However, there are those that would say that the Americans were duped by the British into assisting them with the coup and creating false alarms about the Soviet-Iranian relationship. What is the truth of this?
Unquestionably, the British played on the American fear of communism, and Eisenhower was, as you know better than I, a committed Cold Warrior. And for him and the Dulles brothers, the fear that Iran would go communist was paramount. And when Mossadegh started flirting with the Communist Party in his country, simply he was doing so as a political ruse that tragically backfired. But when he started flirting with the communists, that raised all sorts of alarm bells in Washington. London played that up, and there were visits by British diplomats and by British members of MI6 to their American opposite numbers to convince them that that Iran was about to go communist unless the Americans took very strong action. It is true that Madeleine Albright made an important admission of national culpability when she made those statements. The British have not been quite so forthright, though they have alluded to their role in unsavory activities in 1953. The difference partly is that there was an official CIA history which detailed the activities of the CIA agents involved, in addition to a no-holds-barred autobiography by the coup master himself, Kim Roosevelt. There has been no such frankness on the British side, and the MI6 papers remain closed unless, and that's just a matter of government policy, they're not just closed to me, they're closed to anyone who has not been given specific permission to access those papers. And I tried to access them because I knew that they would give me a lot more about the British role in the actual operational side of the coup. But I can understand why the Brits would not particularly want to release those papers, because frankly they wouldn't show the Brits up in a very flattering light.
You have written an extraordinarily important historical book, and I hope people read Patriot of Persia, Mohammad Mossadegh and a Tragic Anglo-American Coup. Thank you very much for coming on and sharing this from London with us today, Christopher.
Many thanks for having me.
And that my guest, his book is A Patriot of Persia, Christopher Delebelaig, Debelaigue. And just imagine what today the world would be like in the Middle East if we had remained friends with the democratically elected Mossadegh. We wouldn't have all this conflict. Let's say hello to Luann Panessi. By the way, we are coming to the 55-minute mark in our program where many of you will be saying goodbye, the land-based stations. We have many listening. But we can continue this conversation with Luann Panessi, asking your questions by calling in our telephone number, where you can hear anywhere in North America, at 832-280-0066, 832-280-0066, or going to the internet and listening. Nice to have you with us, Luann.
Hi, Gary. Well, I'll tell you what, I don't think I've ever had such a comprehensive history lesson in under an hour. I don't think anyone can get this much information anywhere else in the media ever.
Well, but, the commentary was simple. I'm really fed up with people thinking that our elites, the best and brightest, are going to save us or have the insights. They do not. When Lawrence Summers, a man I consider an economic genocidalist, a man responsible in no small part for the Russian privatization, rush for the gold over there, causing tens of millions of Russians who, after communism, were not given an opportunity to rebuild their economy with fairness. So that was the ascent of the oligarchs. In the United States, he was President Clinton's Secretary of Treasury. He was also the chief economic advisor for Obama. He's the one who said that globalization and privatization were the answers. He never stopped any of the home foreclosures. He never said no to giving the banks a bailout. Had we taken all of the banks and allowed them to go through structural bankruptcies in a reasonable way, today we would have no major debt and we would not have the crisis we're in. So I want to say, take an honest look, do a little homework, do some scholarship, and you'll see that all of our so-called Ivy League best and brightest, these are nothing more than capitalists, fundamentalists, acting on the purity of their original ideology. They are not bastions of open and progressive education. That was the point. Okay?
That's excellent. I understand here, Gary, that I got an email here that you won some pretty prestigious awards last night at the Hoboken Film Festival. And someone made mention of your speech afterwards, which was unlike anything that she'd ever heard before. Not usually what people expect for a thank you speech when someone gets an award. They're usually thanking their mothers and a whole slew of people. Why don't you share with us what happened last night?
All right. I was sitting in the last row. The Hoboken International Film Festival is one of the 10 finest independent film festivals in the world. And because I'm here in New York, I went to it and took some of our staff who worked on the film. And first we won the New York Post Best Trailer out of 2,000 submissions, 10 finalists. We got Best Trailer. Then Best Documentary, and there were some remarkably good documentaries. And we won Best Documentary for American Veterans. And when I got up, I thought in just that moment, just walking down to the podium, what does this moment mean? And they were honoring a Lifetime Achievement Award there with Paul Sorvino, the actor. And I decided first to commend the other documentarians for the outstanding work. And then in my world, I don't believe there is a best. I believe that we all are infused with a genetic attachment to social ideals. And that every time I speak with or see the work of a documentarian, I'm seeing an individual using the tools at their disposal for the audience they can reach to bring an issue to our attention. And with rare exception, these are all essential. So joining them and respecting them was the key, not myself or the film. Secondly, I show that in the history of acting, go back to Paul Muni, go back to Spencer Tracy. One time someone says, gee whiz, Mr. Tracy, it doesn't seem like you're acting. And he said, then that shows you that I am acting. He was able to master his craft. Paul Sorvino, who did The Goodfellow movie and Kissinger, and he played Kissinger in the Nixon movie, and a whole plethora of films that championship season, he comes from the school where you master your craft. That meant that whether it was Udo Hagen or Sandy Meisner or Stravinsky, any of the people that were really great method actors, the last great group was Al Pacino, Merrill Lynch, Glenn Close, William Hurt, Robert De Niro. These people had to master their craft, and that's why some of their best roles were under the guidance of these great teachers. Today, you can see a movie walk out and you'll never remember any part of it because nothing resonated at a high level of quality. You were not watching something that was seamless. You have to see the British or the French or the Italians who still practice that. no matter how successful, they still go back to school. They still master their craft. In America, you don't have to master anything. As long as you're a celebrity or a pretty face or popular or have a big weekend, suddenly you get yes people around you and you never look at another acting class if you ever had one. So I simply acknowledge that we are gifted to have people still in our midst doing films that honor the craft. And that's what remarkable moments in cinema are made from. And we have to look more and more back, because when you look around, all we have is gimmickry, gadgets, high-tech, special effects, photoshopping, and posturing, voguing. And it was just an acknowledgement of him that he was a class act. So, and then I focused upon the vets, and that we can be against their wars, but do not be against them. And I gave examples of how they're suffering and why we should pay attention to setting aside some new resources and energy to help the nearly 1 million homeless vets. So that was the evening, and it was a long evening, and I was happy and felt a privilege to be there to share with so many creative minds. We're out of time. I want to thank you all for listening. Have a nice day. Stay tuned now for Danny Schechter, the News Dissector, multi-award-winning documentarian, a person that takes on the issues, and some of the finest minds on important social issues you will hear exclusively on Danny's show. Back in a moment.